everyone who has ever heard of NASCAR has heard of Dale Earnhardt, and everyone who has heard of Dale Earnhardt knows about his Hall of Fame career as a driver, and likewise all know that Dale was a professional businessman later in his career. Dale Earnhardt and wife Teresa pioneered the Earnhardt family name as a brand that they could build a legacy with that would last a lifetime, or at least they had hoped. During the time that Dale was racing, there was something different about NASCAR back then that you see way more today than you did back then, and that's merchandising. One thing that was true about Dale and his wife Teresa Earnhardt together, they were business geniuses. It's no secret to anyone that Dale Earnhardt knew how to make money just off of his own name. This has led to many trademarks being filed in joint efforts between Richard Childress Racing, Dale Earnhardt, and Teresa Earnhardt. And while these were great for the Earnhardts in the 1990s, later on in life, the issues of who owns what would tear the family and company apart. There were many ways that Dale Earnhardt's name was used to build businesses, and the family definitely benefited from these. If you go to a NASCAR race today, you are still very likely to find Earnhardt merchandise like hats, diecast cars, and t-shirts. Only very rarely will any new merchandise be released today though. Most is still left over from the Earnhardt boom of the 1990s. Not only did Dale and Teresa find ways to create a boom for personal merchandising, but they created partnerships to brand with other companies with Dale's name and image. Dale's appearance on the front of a Wheaties box is a great example, and Dale even had a boat named after him. The Gambler Intimidator was the joint effort of Gambler Bass Boats and Earnhardt. Today, this really fast bass boat is still a boat that people love to find and own and fish out of. All of those efforts alone could be enough to be proud of, but they did not stop there. Being the proud Chevy man that he was, it only made sense for Earnhardt to put his name on his very own car dealership. Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet was opened up in July of 1987, and even today, in 2019, it's still open under the Earnhardt name in Newton, North Carolina. Now, after all those business efforts, the Earnhardt family name would finally launch as a racing team in 1995 when Dale Earnhardt Incorporated would compete in the NASCAR Truck Series with NASCAR Hall of Famer Ron Hornaday in the number 16 truck. DEI would also field a 76 truck for a total of 4 starts during this time as well. Not long after this, DEI would begin their racing efforts in NASCAR's Busch Series, where they most notably would see Dale Earnhardt Jr. become a 2-time Busch Series champion in 1998 and 1999. Dale Earnhardt Incorporated would also develop other well-known racers such as Paul Menard, who got his first Busch Series victory for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated in 2006, and through Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s business venture Chance 2 Motorsports, an extension of DEI, we would also see the introduction of 2017 Cup Series champion Martin Truex Jr. Truex Jr. won back-to-back championships in 2004 and 2005 in the Busch Series, and then this partnership would go on to disappear until Dale Jr. would re-emerge with his new team of Junior Motorsports, only this team had nothing to do with Teresa Earnhardt. But on that note, I believe I'm getting too far ahead of myself. DEI's first Cup Series entrant was Steve Park. Park did deliver some wins for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, but unfortunately he's well known for injuries which put him out of action, including one in 1998 after a crash in practice at Atlanta Motor Speedway. This would result in one of Dale Earnhardt's greatest rivals, Darrell Waltrip, stepping in to race in the one car until Park returned. Park would go on to pick up his first win for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated at Watkins Glen in 2000, and it gave hope that Dale Earnhardt's driver investment was paying off. Then in 1999, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated brought Dale Earnhardt Jr. into the Cup Series, where he would see great successes, including his breakout season of 2004, featuring a 5th place points finish, 21 top 10s, 16 top 5s, and 6 wins, including the first of 2 Daytona 500s. The other major factor in DEI's driver stable was Michael Waltrip in the 15 from 2001 to 2005. Michael Waltrip brought Napa on board as a sponsor, and they were behind him for his entire time at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. These three, in my opinion, were the dream team at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Between the three drivers, they accounted for 23 wins at DEI. The team was poised for great success going into the 2001 season, but unfortunately, that's where the first strikes come from in the fall of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. At the 2001 Daytona 500, Michael Waltrip did win his first Cup Series race, but team owner Dale Earnhardt did tragically lose his life in a last lap crash at Daytona. It was devastating. Devastating for Waltrip, devastating for the sport, devastating for the team, Richard Childress Racing and the 3-team, Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet, and especially devastating for the Earnhardt family. When Dale was gone, it gave Teresa Earnhardt exclusive control and ownership of the team, the Earnhardt brand, and everything else that they own together. And again, like many families, control of possession after a loved one passes can usually be what tears families apart. But regardless, DEI still had to go racing. Teresa said it herself in a documentary, Dale, that she really didn't have much choice. race. The team would go on to have their fair share of successes after Dale Earnhardt's passing, most notably being the 2004 Daytona 500 and championship-contending season of Dale Jr. in 2004, along with two Daytona 500 victories for Michael Waltrip as well. However, after 2004, many could argue that DEI was quickly on a downward spiral then. In 2005 and 2006, Dale Earnhardt Jr. would only get one win in each of those seasons and would finish very low in points. Michael Waltrip left Dale Earnhardt Incorporated after 2005, and partner Napa Auto Parts followed him as he went on to start Michael Waltrip Racing. Steve Park would also eventually stop racing due to injury, and then a host of drivers would spend time in the one car until Martin Truex Jr. would stick with the team until the end of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated with the support of sponsor Bass Pro Shops. Paul Menard came in after Waltrip left with the support of his family's hardware store Menards, and Menard would stay until the end as well. Finally, the next truly big impact was in 2007 when Dale Earnhardt Jr. went winless for the first time, and he announced he would be leaving Dale Earnhardt Incorporated and the 8 car at the end of the year. Budweiser was also not returning to the team as they joined Casey Kane and Ray Evernham Motorsports in 2008. Veteran driver Mark Martin would bring sponsor Army along with him as he raced part-time along with Eric Almirola in the 8 car in 2008, but this did not last long. Mark Martin also went on to go to Hendrick Motorsports the following season, just as well as Dale Jr. did, and Army joined Ryan Newman at Stewart Haas Racing in 2009. There was also Regan Smith in the 01 car at the end of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, but not much happened for him there. He would join Furniture Row Racing the following season. The truth is that while all of these changes were happening, Teresa Earnhardt and Dale Jr. were in a brutal legal battle over the ownership of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated for many years. Dale Jr. won a majority ownership in 2007, but Teresa was preventing it from happening. Other drivers in the garage also had not so good words for Teresa Earnhardt as well. Kevin Harvick was quoted as referring to her as a deadbeat owner, adding that Dale Jr. deserves the respect of being a grown man and not being treated like he's 15 and somebody's stepson. Again, that's Harvick's words, not mine. On top of this, in December of 2006, a story in the Wall Street Journal quoted Teresa as saying the ball was in Dale Jr.'s court to decide on whether he wants to be a NASCAR driver or whether he wants to be a public personality. Looking back on this, I don't think anybody should now be surprised that Dale Jr. left in 2007, stopped Chance 2 Motorsports, only to open Jr. Motorsports again in 2 years with absolutely zero connection to Teresa Earnhardt. Honestly, I'm surprised they didn't do it sooner. When the family split and went their own ways in their own unique businesses, Jr. Motorsports was responsible for starting the career of Cup Series champion Brad Keselowski, Danica Patrick coming to NASCAR, and 3 championships in the Xfinity Series with 3 different drivers. Meanwhile, what happened to DEI? Sponsors left. That's what happened. Maybe Teresa didn't want Dale Jr.'s help in 2007, but by 2009 she sure did need the help of Chip Ganassi when she sold partnership to him to form Earnhardt Ganassi Racing with drivers Martin Truex Jr. in the 1 car, Juan Pablo Montoya in the 42, and Eric Almirola in the 8 until Texas that season. After that, the 8 was gone in NASCAR until Richard Childress Racing brought it back in 2018. Side note, despite being the same font RCR used before DEI, they cannot use that font for the 8 due to trademarks and ownership legal actions of Teresa, so that's why Daniel Hemrick's 8 is how it is today. In 2010, the team had really no more way of resembling Dale Earnhardt Incorporated other than the font of Jamie McMurray's 1 car and Bass Pro Shop sponsorship. This partnership would continue until 2013, and by 2014, Teresa Earnhardt was completely out of the organization, and the team was just Chip Ganassi Racing. The team changed McMurray's font due to legal reasons, and the team was exclusively Ganassi Racing after that. Just like that, Family Feud and the fight for power had brought down Dale Earnhardt's creation. Junior Motorsports still has potential to be a legendary team in NASCAR, but as for DEI, all it is today is a museum and a small retail store. Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet still exists but is ran by its own management crew today. Teresa is relatively silent around NASCAR but is still a sore subject, and many often practice caution with anything related to DEI. Perfect example, 10 years after Dale's passing, Waltrip intended to pay respects to DEI with a paint scheme using the same design and number font on his number 15 Toyota. Well, when they got to Daytona, they reduced the number of stripes on the car and couldn't use the same font on the entire car, only the roof. I wonder why this happened. More recently, Kannapolis, North Carolina-based baseball team, the Kannapolis Intimidators, recently announced that they would be changing their name. The reason is because they can't own the name because somebody else does. These same worries have even applied to Dale's oldest son, Kerry Earnhardt, as he faced issues with the right to use his birth name for his own company. After all of this, it's clear when and why the fall of DEI happened, and it's a real shame of how its story ended. All we can do today is give support to the museum that still exists and Junior Motorsports and all that they do. With all this being said, what do you think about the DEI story? Go ahead and leave a comment so I can read it. Also, maybe suggest another team you'd like to hear about the rise and fall of. I also ask that you go ahead and give this video a like, and if this is your first time seeing my channel, then please go ahead and hit the subscribe button and click the notification button to never miss a video. You can also follow me on Twitter at DannyBTalks, and with that, this is Danny B, and I hope you have a great day. Bye, guys.